Happy Tuesday, fifth day of October 2021. I am Dan Kuntz. Welcome to Wake Up Wenatchee Valley. Thanks for starting your day with us on a cloudy day, the last day of fairly mild temperatures, maybe for a long time. We'll be kissing 70 degrees. We're not going to see a lot of sunshine today. And then here comes a pretty active cold front. It's going to come in tomorrow morning, pretty much about 24 hours from now. We're going to have a lot of sunshine Wednesday and Thursday and Friday, but oh boy, those temperatures are going to cool down a lot. And in fact, we'll see overnight lows in the 30s before this week is out. I kid you not. Now, we're not going to get any rain, although there could be a little bit of light snow up in Mission Ridge. So just throwing that out there. Complete weather forecast details are coming up. It's pretty typical autumn weather. We'd like the sunshine, but it is going to be chilly. I'm going to have to see if my furnace works. Hope it does. Haven't had it on since, I don't know, April maybe, maybe even March. News? Yeah. Sports? Yeah. In fact, for the first time in a long time, we're talking about Wenatchee Wild hockey. They're getting ready to gear up for their season. Of course, the Wenatchee Wild had no hockey last year because of COVID travel restrictions, being the only American team in the British Columbia Hockey League. Even up in British Columbia, to the north of us, they didn't really have much of a season last year anyway. Wenatchee Wild had no season at all. That has all changed. They're going to start strapping on the skates and checking guys into the boards, blue lines, red lines, face-offs. We're pretty pumped about that. Wenatchee Wild Hockey is right on the cusp of returning. They don't play here at the Town Toyota Center for another month or so. They're going to play the first 8 games on the road. We'll explain all of that when we get to sports. Plus, we'll preview tonight's game between the Yankees and the Red Sox as the baseball playoffs get underway tonight. I can't tell you how much I love this time of the year. The baseball playoffs, Major League Baseball playoffs, are my absolute favorite time of the year. You get games that count every day. Every pitch is intense. They go that long 162-game marathon. The 10 teams of the 30 teams in the Major League Baseball make their way into the playoffs. Everybody hits Control-Alt-Delete, and now it's a sprint to the finish. I love it. I'm excited about tonight and everything else that you need. And October is Domestic Violence Awareness Month, and one of our very best friends here on the NCW Live channel is Jessica Johnson, the Executive Director of SAGE, and she and Hank came by and paid me a visit yesterday. We went over to the other control room, the other studio, to record our conversation. Jessica Johnson, SAGE, good stuff, important stuff, sobering, yes, but important. Nevertheless, Jessica Johnson will be our guest in the back half of the program. 3 minutes after the hour, overcast, 54 degrees. We begin our tour now with sunrise. The sun is just peeking over the East Wenatchee Bench. If you look to the east, you'll see a gorgeous glowing red sky. Sunrise officially still isn't for a few more minutes. Sunrise is at 7:06 this morning. Sunset tonight, 6:31. 11 hours and 25 minutes of daylight. We've lost 24 minutes of daylight just in a week. It's that time of the year. Good morning to the valley. We have the cross cam tilted up and zoomed back as we look out over the Columbia, the lifeblood of North Central Washington. Camera number 2. Uriah wants to go see Lake Wenatchee, and by golly, we are. We used this camera last week, and you couldn't see Lake Wenatchee. It was all fogged over. Not the case today. Good morning to Lake Wenatchee. Good morning to the Kaler Glen Golf and Ski Resort. Good morning to Dirty Face Mountain. A spectacular view there. Fish Lake, can't quite make it out. It's on the right-hand side of your screen. So good morning to our friends there. And the Headwaters, kind of wave to my friends at the Headwaters. I've been there a few times. Good morning, Lake Wenatchee. Camera number 3. Wow. Let's just look at that. Let's just look at that all day. Is that number 1 canyon camera? That is just stunning. Look at that, right at the sunset, right at the sunrise. I'm sorry, right at the sunrise. Gee, let's just stare at that all day. Beautiful. We didn't manipulate that. That's the real deal. That's what it's looking at right now. I'm speechless. Camera 4. Oh, well, Wenatchee. No, I'm just kidding. We love downtown Wenatchee from the top of the Cascadia. We have 2 cameras, one points south, one points north. We're pointing down south. On Wenatchee Avenue on the early morning commute. Very light traffic on this Tuesday. Some great views this morning, especially that number 1 canyon camera. That was just crazily good. All right, a couple of slides to show for you from the National Weather Service. First of all, today is going to be a little breezy, especially this afternoon, as we start seeing that cold front begin to make its presence felt. So a little windy in the places that are used to having the winds. The Okanagan Valley, the Waterville Plateau, and the far western Columbia Basin. We're going to see winds here in the Wenatchee Valley sustained right around 10 miles an hour, but we are going to see gusts as high as 20 miles an hour, maybe even close to 30 miles an hour at times, those rogue gusts that fly in and fly out. So a little breezy, all of it in the afternoon hours. As soon as the sun goes down, we should see the winds die down as well. So get ready for some wind today, and then get ready for some chilly temperatures. Depending on where you live, some locations are going to be down to close to freezing. Those places that are prone to super cold overnight lows. Here in the Wenatchee Valley, we're going to see overnight lows in the 30s, but we're not going to get down to the freezing mark. So we're not there yet. But there will be some locations that will see very chilly temperatures for overnight lows starting tomorrow night and lasting really for the rest of the week before some clouds will start putting the blanket on over the valley, make things a tad warmer. So without further ado from the National Weather Service, clouds today, yeah, for the most part, high around 71. Didn't quite hit our goal. Our goal yesterday was 73. We hit 69. Normal high this time of the year is 68. Lots of clouds. Afternoon winds, 71 for the afternoon high, 43 for the overnight low tonight. Here comes that cold front. It's going to start coming in tonight. You're going to wake up tomorrow morning. It'll be about 43 degrees. It's not going to warm up much than that. 63. Lots of sunshine. Quite chilly. And look at the overnight low Wednesday night into Thursday, 38 degrees. And then only 62 and 62, back-to-back 62s. Again, sunshine prominent, but temperatures about 6 to 8 degrees below normal for the afternoon high. Overnight lows in the 30s. Wednesday night into Thursday night, only a little bit warmer on Friday night. Lots of sunshine on Saturday. A late afternoon system begins to make its presence felt right around sunset Saturday night. And that means we could see some rain on Sunday and Monday, and as I mentioned before, maybe even a little bit of light snow on Mission Ridge. The snow level on Monday, Columbus Day, is going to go all the way down to 2,800 feet. Now, there's not going to be a lot of moisture in the air, very little at all, but whatever comes down above 2,800 feet early on Monday morning could come down in the form of snow. It ain't going to last very long, not with a high of 58, but first time we've talked about snow in the upper elevations in a while. Okay, at your forecast. We're going to take a break at 8 minutes after the hour and come back with the news that you need to start your Tuesday. You're watching Wake Up Wenatchee Valley on the NCW Life Channel.
Kids are resilient. I just love their energy. They bounce back so quickly. I love the stories they tell. I love just their charisma, their character. I love to see that subtle smile that you pull out of a kid, you know, when you start talking with them about something they really like. I just love what I do, and I can't imagine I would be as happy doing anything else.
Are you a take charge kind of person? Consider a career as a health unit coordinator. You'll work to keep health facilities running efficiently by coordinating medical providers, patients, and departments. The Charter College Certificate in Health Unit Coordinator program can get you up to speed on basic patient care, health records management, health and safety procedures, and medical billing. And the 10-month online program includes a computer you keep. Get started at chartercollege.edu, where we work to get you to work.
Nine minutes after the hour on this Tuesday, lots of clouds, lower 70s today. Cold front begins to roll in overnight tonight. Lots of sunshine, but very cool temperatures for this time of the year. On Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, a slight warm-up with a few more clouds by the weekend. We begin with this story. Police continue to search for a suspect in a drive-by shooting last week in Moses Lake, in which several bullets were fired into the room of a home where a child was sitting. The Grant County Sheriff's Office said that there were no injuries in the shooting. The shooting, by the way, happened about 9:30 in the evening last Thursday in the 1,000 block of Vandenberg Loop. That's in the Larson community of Moses Lake. Deputies said two homes and a vehicle hit by bullets. The sheriff's office said a man seen standing by the vehicle that was struck may have been the intended victim, but he has not been located. As many as four bullets entered the living room of one of the homes, but the child in the room was not hit. A 62-year-old Wenatchee woman was seriously injured, had to be airlifted, as a matter of fact, to Central Washington Hospital. This after a head-on collision happened yesterday morning on Highway 243 near Beverly. The Washington State Patrol said Linda D. Burtz was driving a 2014 Mazda CX-5 southbound at about 6 in the morning yesterday when her vehicle drifted into the northbound lane and hit a 2018 Chevrolet Impala head-on. Now, the extent of her injuries has not been made public. The driver of the Impala, 28-year-old Jona Ramirez-Cruz of Mattawa, she suffered a minor injury, and after the head-on collision, a 2008 Subaru Legacy being driven northbound by 18-year-old Ohehe Yordi of Beverly struck Burt's vehicle. Yordi not injured. The State Patrol said the accident remains under investigation. No citations, as of yet, have been issued. A missing 77-year-old mushroom picker and a woman who got lost while looking for the mushroom picker were both rescued Friday after being missing overnight in the Chihuahua River area. The Chelan County Sheriff's Office said Raleigh Schmitten went missing about 2 o'clock on Thursday, and the woman who had been picking mushrooms with him notified his wife, who then called authorities. The Sheriff's Office said the friend then got lost searching for Schmitten. Deputies, the search and rescue and mountain rescue teams searched for the pair until about midnight, and then they resumed the search in the morning. The woman was found about 8 a.m., and then Schmitten was located along a riverbank by a helicopter crew. The woman and Raleigh Schmitten, cold but unharmed. October 18th is the deadline for all medical workers in this state to be fully vaccinated against COVID-19. So with less than 2 weeks until that date, Confluence Health says 86% of all of its staff have achieved that mark. That's up from 73% when Governor Jay Inslee announced the mandate back in August. 97% of physicians practicing in Confluence hospitals and clinics have now been fully vaccinated. But figures provided to NCW Live show almost 8% of Confluence's 4,600 employees are seeking exemptions from the vaccine requirement, the vast majority of them citing religious beliefs. Inslee's executive order makes full vaccination a requirement for medical employment in this state. Confluence Health says since the governor's order, 23 people have resigned as a direct result of the vaccine mandate. Health system spokesman Andrew Canning says the employees who chose to not be vaccinated have had the opportunity to take a personal leave of absence for 12 weeks and then return to work if they decide to complete the vaccination process during their leave. Like so many healthcare services, Mid-Valley Hospital in Omak, they have been struggling to care for COVID-19 patients. Okanagan County reported up to 550 new cases a day back in September, and the most severely ill have filled up the beds at Mid-Valley Hospital. Okanagan County Public Health produced a short documentary on the experience of hospital nurses during the pandemic. It's called COVID in the Country.
Nursing supervisor, this is Allison. Okay.
You want me to write it down?
Could you do that for me?
Where is it going?
ER. We have had to essentially move our COVID capacity out this way, so past those double doors, which were under a negative pressure, which we are no longer able to maintain that. It just seems to have exploded in the county. So this is something you can take a look at here is staffing. Nurses, how are they are assigned? So we started the morning, anything that's highlighted meant that they were discharged home. Anything that's circled, it means it's a new admit for us today. They're working with no aid, and each of them had up to 5 patients apiece.
How you doing, sweetie? Pull your hose up here. Oh, it's pretty exhausting. You know, doing this for since the beginning, and you go home and you worry about them. Sometimes they're not always here when you come back. I would say emotionally, this is the most difficult.
the things we notice with COVID positive patients with their respiratory is any activity causes them to desat. So we're constantly monitoring lots of people on telemetry. This shows their oxygenation, this 99 right here. We have run out of telemetry units, so not all of our patients can be on telemetry all the time, so we have to make accommodations for that as well, who the higher priority is for the telemetry.
Finally, on this Tuesday, wild bighorn sheep that graze in and around the Wenatchee area have tested positive for pneumonia-causing bacteria that can be deadly to herds. The Washington Department of Fish and Wildlife say samples from the Quillamine herd last month show the presence of MOVI bacteria. Now, last week, the department began searching the herd's range by helicopter, and they found at least one juvenile sheep with pneumonia symptoms. And if you observe bighorn sheep coughing or displaying other abnormal behavior, you're being asked to contact the Fish and Wildlife South Central office at 575-2740. You're in the loop on what's making news on this Tuesday, the fifth day of October. We'll have a newscast for you tonight. We have Grant Olson in the anchor chair. He also does the weather forecasting, does both pretty good. With a preview, here's Grant.
Good morning, Dan. Coming up tonight on the NCW Life Evening News, today just might be our last 70-degree day this year because much cooler air is moving in tomorrow. I'll have all the details in your complete North Central Washington weather forecast. And in sports, Eric Granstrom will be here with a preview to tonight's high school sports action. That and all the day's news stories coming up tonight at 5, 6, and 10 on the NCW Life Evening News. We hope to see you then. Dan?
Thanks, Grant. Don't forget, if you have a news tip or you just want to drop us a note and say hi, we try to make it as easy as possible. Look at the bottom of your screen. You can use our Facebook app if it's running. You can go to our homepage, which is running. I can confirm that. I have it up right now. NCWLife.com. You can drop us a note that way, or you can email us directly, news@NCWLife.com. After a quick break, we finally get to talk a little Wenatchee Wild Hockey. It's been a long time, but they're ready to take to the ice. We'll also preview high school sports. We'll have the obscure holiday today in history, some celebrity birthdays, an opinion from Mike Mad Dog Magnotti, and my conversation with Jessica Johnson, the executive director of SAGE, highlighting October being Domestic Violence Awareness Month. We have a busy Tuesday for you. Don't go anywhere. Sports is in 1 minute. You're watching Wake Up in Wenatchee Valley on the NCW Life Channel.
Badger Mountain Brewing is proud to announce the grand opening of our new kitchen. Come try out our new menu featuring fabulous steaks, prime rib, gourmet burgers, and seafood grilled up by experienced meat master, Chef Galen Goodman. To complement your mouth-watering meal, Badger Mountain Brewing features 14 in-house crafted beers, an alcohol-free root beer infused with 11 different herbs and spices, 3 different ciders, and a great wine selection. Don't miss out on the best meats and the best brews down at Badger Mountain Brewing, located at 1 Arondo Avenue across the tracks from the Pybus Market.
When your heating or cooling system is giving you trouble, call the diagnostic doctor from Dick's Heating and Air Conditioning.
Here's the culprit right here.
All joking aside, when you call Dick's, you're calling 35 years of experience at customer service right here in the Wenatchee Valley. Dick's strongly believes in repairing before replacing, and they service all major brands of HVAC units. We are back with sports. 582 days. Eric did the math. By the time the Wenatchee Wild take to the ice up in Canada this Saturday, that's how long it would have been since they played hockey. 582 days. Back on March 6th, 2020, the Wild lost Game 5 to the Vernon Vipers in the playoffs. Arch Ecker had the call back then.
So for the second year in a row, the Wenatchee Wild and Vernon Vipers will shake hands here on this ice surface. The Vipers will move on in the Wild series. Wild season comes to an end. As these players are going to come together and they fist bump, and you know, there's just so much, all the chat about coronavirus, so nobody wants to shake hands. But they will roll through and bump fists, at least. handshake line at center ice as the season comes to an end.
Of course, nobody knew it at the time, but that turned out to be the last game of the 2020 season. The rest of the playoffs were wiped out by COVID, and because they closed the border, Wenatchee had no hockey at all. Last season, head coach Chris Clark said there's no better way to get back into the ice than to take on one of the top rivals in the league on Saturday.
I think that'll be a great night, obviously. Like you said, I didn't know it was that many days, but when you put that number out there, it's definitely been a lot, and no better way to get our feet back wet in the league by playing our biggest rival in the Penticton Vs, and that'll be a great test and an exciting atmosphere, I know for sure.
All right, let's take a look at the first part of the Wenatchee Wild schedule. It's all up in Canada, as you know by now. The border is still closed for land travel into the U.S., so the BCHL is going to fly teams to Seattle, and then the Wild will pick them up in their bus and bring them to Wenatchee so they can play here at the Town Toyota Center. The teams will then bus back into Canada. The Wild, meanwhile, will head to Canada on an extended trip. As you see there, that's a very long road trip. So Wenatchee will play 8 games north of the border before they finally open at home on November 11th and 12th against West Kelowna. All right, closer to home. On the NCAA Live channel tonight, we got girls soccer, the Wenatchee Panthers, Sunnyside Grizzlies, Lee Boffel Field at the Apple Bowl. Eric Granstrom, Matt Wiseman will have the call. Pregame, 6:45. They'll start playing soccer at 7 o'clock. Also on the schedule today, Quincy travels to OMAC. Tenasca will host Brewster in girls soccer. That's at 4. Liberty Bell takes on Okanagan and Brewster's at Pateras. 4:30 starts there. At 6, you got a Friday at Grandview and Cascade host Chelan. The other 7 o'clock game, besides the Panthers and the Grizzlies, has Moses Lake on the road to take on Eisenhower to prep volleyball tonight. Oroville visits Liberty Bell at 5. Antioch plays at Cascade Christian at 5:30. At 6:30, you got Chelan at Cascade. OMAC hosts Quincy. Manson travels to Brewster, and Waterville-Mansfield will take on Pateras later at 7 in volleyball. Wenatchee at Sunnyside, Moses Lake hosts Eisenhower. Grandview plays at Alfreda, and Bridgeport takes on Soap Lake. Seahawks, just one little bitty short week. They played on Sunday. They turn right around and play Thursday night at home, and they got the Rams coming into town. Coach Pete Carroll met with reporters on Monday. He said he's still in awe of Sunday's performance of Russell Wilson.
When you take it out there, the first series, and you get dumped and you get sacked, and the second series again, and the third series again, it's a challenge to anybody in any endeavor. You know, how do you hang when it starts that difficult and it looks bleak and all that? And he didn't even falter. He didn't waver. He hung right there and came back just like we know him always, just did it again, you know, and put together an excellent game for us. One of my favorite games because of that, the circumstances on the road, the crowd, all of that. The pass rush was roaring. And then after the first three, they didn't get him again, you know. And when he needed to get out, he did. When he needed to scramble to throw it and win the game with a touchdown pass, he did it. So I was really proud of that outing, and thought it was one of his classics. I thought it was really, to me, it's one of the real special ones.
The Rams are coming off their first loss of the season. They lost Sunday to the Cardinals. Of course, the Seahawks are 2-2 after beating the 49ers, and kickoff Thursday night again at Quest Field. It will be at 5:20. The Major League Baseball postseason begins tonight. Let's go Yankees. Dun, 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 dun. American League wildcard game, Fenway Park. Two teams that are quite familiar with each other over the last 115 years or so. The Boston Red Sox, New York Yankees. Gerrit Cole starts for New York. Nathan Eovaldi goes for Boston. First pitch, ESPN 508. The National League wildcard game tomorrow at Dodger Stadium. The Dodgers and the Cardinals. And those are just some of the games that people are playing on this October 5th. We don't want to wish everybody out there in the teaching profession happy World Teachers Day. Goes back to October 5th, 1994, when the first World Teachers Day was recognized and organized. A couple of years later, it became an official holiday. Events are being held all over the world for teachers. We all remember the teachers who made a difference when we were growing up. I'm almost 40 years past my formal education with the Wenatchee School District, and now you remember the teachers who made an impact, the ones that leaned forward, that gave a damn, as opposed to the ones that just didn't seem to be phoning it in. You remember them. You remember them for a long, long time. So appreciate your teachers, not just the current teachers today, but teachers everywhere. Who they say one of the greatest barometers of a healthy community is a good professional teaching organization. I believe it's true. Happy World Teachers Day today. That's why I put a banana on my desk. 25 minutes after the hour. This is it. Today is the day. Talked about this yesterday. The 90th anniversary of one of the most iconic moments in Wenatchee Valley's history. 90 years ago today, October 5th, 1931, Clyde Pangborn and Hugh Herndon made it. They'd landed their plane, the Miss Vidal, on that dirt strip that was cut out of the sagebrush up on Fancher Heights, Fancher Fields, above East Wenatchee, and became the first people to fly nonstop across the Pacific Ocean. Took them 41 hours and 13 minutes. That is the headline of the New York Times. That is the headline of the Seattle Times that very same day with a famous photo. Of course, there's no landing gear. They had to ditch it. And we also have a video of the headlines of the Wenatchee Daily World from October 5th, 1931. But the Wenatchee Valley on the map. Of course, it was a remarkable flight. They were carrying twice as much gas as the plane was designed to fly, but they needed that much gas to get there. And once they took off, they jettisoned the landing gear. Well, sort of. Half the gear came off like it was supposed to. They needed to reduce the drag, and the other half stayed on the plane. They had to crawl out and bust it off themselves. But they made it on this date. Clyde Pangborn, Hugh Herndon, 90 years ago today. Of course, the propeller is still here. What happened to the Miss Vidal? Well, they fixed it. They fixed it up. They put it on the truck. They trucked it back to Seattle. They put new landing gear on it. Clyde Pangborn and Hugh Herndon flew to New York. Eventually, the Miss Vidal was sold, was renamed the American Nurse. And in 1932, less than a year after they'd landed in East Wenatchee on a flight from New York to Rome for aviation medical research, disappeared. Miss Vidal's gone. Just nobody knows what happened to it. It simply disappeared on a flight somewhere between New York and Rome, somewhere over the Atlantic. So the Miss Vidal is gone, Johnson. But we had the propeller 90 years ago today. And the very first James Bond film was released to movie theaters on this date 59 years ago today, October 5th, 1962. Of course, based on the novels by Ian Fleming, the very first Bond movie, Dr. No, came out. No Time to Die is in theaters now, which is the 25th official release in the James Bond series. Combined grosses of $7 billion to date. The James Bond film series is the sixth highest grossing film series of all time. If you adjust it for inflation, $14 billion. James Bond began his cinematic journey on this date back in 1962. Some of the films are really good, some not so much. Let's do birthdays, shall we? We always do presidents. Chester A. Arthur, there you go. The 21st president of the United States, born in the state in 1829, where we're not sure. Two towns in Vermont claim to be the birthplace of Chester A. Arthur. 1829, records were kind of sketchy. His political opponents claimed he was born in Canada, and the only adult in-depth biography of Chester Allen Arthur also claims that he was probably born in Canada, which means he wouldn't have been eligible to be president of the United States. He had never run for public office before until he ran on the James Garfield ticket for vice president, Garfield for president, Arthur for vice president. He had never run for office before. Of course, James Garfield was elected and then got shot and got killed, and Chester A. Arthur took over the presidency, and everybody went, well, that's really not what we planned, but what do you do? Now, those are some mutton chops. Chester A. Arthur attempted to run for the presidency on his own volition, but he didn't even win the nomination of the Republican Party the next presidential election cycle. But for about 3.5 years, he was the president of the United States, born in the state in 1829. Ray Kroc, the American businessman and philanthropist, he gave a lot of his money away, born in the state in 1902, died in 1984 at the age of 81. Of course, he joined the California-based McDonald's chain in 1954, tried to get them to the McDonald's brothers to really franchise out and expand out and go. They were a little leery. Ray Kroc was very aggressive. The McDonald's brothers, not so much. So in 1961, he bought out the McDonald's brothers for $1 million each. A pretty smart investment. There are about 37,000 McDonald's worldwide. And the guy who made McDonald's a household word, Ray Kroc, born in the state In 1902, Barry Switzer, one of three coaches to win an NCAA national championship and a Super Bowl. The other are Jimmy Johnson and, of course, Pete Carroll. Barry Switzer, one of the greatest coaches at the University of Oklahoma, won three national championships with Oklahoma and Super Bowl 30 with the Dallas Cowboys. He's 84 years old today. Some people call him the Space Cowboy. Some people call him the Gangster of Love. I call him Maurice. Happy birthday, Steve Miller, 78 years old today, in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, and it took way too long for that. This concludes my commentary on Steve Miller. Going to take a break. Got an opinion from Mike Mad Dog McNaughty, and then I had an opportunity to sit down with Jessica Johnson, the executive director of SAGE, and she brought Hank along with her. October is Domestic Violence Awareness Month. Jessica joins us next. You're watching Wake Up in Anchie Valley on the NCW Life Channel.
Hi, folks. Welcome to Save Mart. How can we help you today?
We're looking for a recliner.
Okay, right this way.
Great. I want that one. I like that one.
That's a great choice.
And I want this one as well.
Okay.
And I definitely want this one.
Ooh. You'll find it at Save Mart. Full service at a low, low price.
When Mike leaves town, it's a little scary. You never know who might be outside. But we feel safer inside, knowing our home is being monitored by a local company. I can check our alarm from just about anywhere, so when we get home, I know it's safe.
Protect your family and save money with a local company. Switch your current security monitoring to Guardian Services from Localtel. Call Guardian Security from Localtel now, or visit localtel.net to learn more.
Arctic Refrigeration and Heating has been providing heating and cooling services in our valley since 1984. Arctic offers a variety of refrigeration and heating services, proudly now selling Bryant Systems, heating and air conditioning for your home or business, commercial refrigeration service for your coolers, freezers, and prep tables, and now, full service on gas fireplaces for your home or business. Whatever it takes, Arctic Refrigeration and Heating, the temperature experts.
Hi, I'm Jim Heinlein, independent agent and owner at Springwater Insurance Group here in North Central Washington. And it's that time of year again, October 15th to December 7th. That is the time if you have a Medicare plan, do I want to keep it or do I want to change it? For any of those questions, give us a call at Springwater Insurance Group because we're independent agents. We don't work with one company. We work with many companies because all of you have different situations and needs. So if you have questions about 2021 Medicare plans, give us a call, 888-2600.
Homeward bound, I wish I was homeward bound. Home, where my thoughts escaping, home, where my music's playing, home, where my love lies waiting silently for me, silently for me.
Dr. Wayne Latimer's Chiropractic and Integrative Multicare specializes in all level of injury care. If you've been injured in an auto accident, on the job, have a sports injury, or a simple fall, call today for a free consultation. They offer a combined multicare approach with medical, chiropractic, physical therapy, massage, and acupuncture. For relief from long-standing injuries to basic solutions for the weekend warrior, Latimer's Chiropractic Integrative Multicare is one stop, one location.
Are you dealing with a pest or weed issue and you just don't know what to do?
We use the best pest control methods approved for areas with kids and pets.
Whether it's rats, mice, ants, or spiders.
Or something else altogether.
We provide the coaching and solutions you're looking for.
And you can know that your dollars are supporting a local, family-owned and operated business.
Allow us to help you get back to living healthy and pest-free.
Harvest Valley Pest Control.
Mary Maids of Wenatchee has been professionally cleaning and sanitizing homes and businesses in North Central Washington since 1998. Mary Maids uses commercial-grade cleaners and viricides. Mary Maids has implemented additional safety and sanitation protocols. They are strictly following CDC guidelines for the safety of their clients and employees. For expert help with cleaning and sanitizing your home or business, call or look up Mary Maids of Wenatchee to schedule your free estimate today. As the sun sets on another hot summer, let the experts at Blue Lagoon Pool and Spa winterize and close your pool. Closing your swimming pool is the most important service to get right. Letting the professionals from Blue Lagoon Pool and Spa close your pool will ensure that you won't cost yourself thousands of dollars in damage next year. Want to save a little money? Consider dropping the water level yourself and save. Don't wait. Blue Lagoon's pool closing schedule is filling up quickly. Call today.
At Wenatchee Power Sports, we proudly offer the Polaris product line. Polaris builds the highest quality side-by-side in the industry, with off-road capability that's second to none. The Polaris pre-order program allows customers to purchase the vehicle they want without having to select from limited dealer inventory. The Wenatchee Valley has year-round access to some of the best ORV trails in the Northwest. Start your adventure here at Wenatchee Power Sports.
Think premium can't be capable? Think again. Introducing the first ever AT4 lineup. Premium and capable. That's professional grade from GMC.
Mike Mad Dog Magnotti, and everybody is entitled to my opinion. Now, whether you're a Christian or not, we all have some idea of who Jesus is, right? But have you heard about the new Jesus, the one that some Christians are talking about, who I call the magic trick Jesus? Now, this is the Jesus who, even though you might catch a cold, the flu, or God forbid, sometimes have cancer in your life, the magic trick Jesus is the one who will keep you from getting COVID. Now, if you believe in the magic trick Jesus, you don't have to wear a mask or get vaccinated, because by doing so, you're demonstrating a lack of faith. By wearing a mask or getting vaccinated or not doing these things, you're showing what a strong believer you are in the magic trick Jesus. Now, by the way, this magic trick Jesus is not the one that the Bible talks about. This is Mike Mad Dog Magnotti, and everybody is entitled to my opinion.
Opioids are now one of the leading causes of injury-related deaths in Washington state. More people die from overdose than from car crashes. Between 2012 and 2016, more than 3,300 lives in Washington were lost to opioid overdose. We are all part of the solution. Your choices matter. If you are prescribed an opioid pain medication, talk with your doctor about other options, and don't share your prescriptions with other people. It starts with you. Learn more at GetTheFactsRx.com.
Counterplay inside, picking his way back to the 10, to the 5.
High school sports is back, and NCW Life Channel's got you covered. Tune in for football, girls soccer, and volleyball right here. Thanks to our sponsors, Harvest Valley Pest Control, Rivercom 911, and Sangster Motors. Follow all the action of high school sports on your local TV station, the NCW Life Channel.
At Washington Trust Bank, can't is a four-letter word.
I think we should hire more people.
Doc, I'm late for a meeting.
I'm thinking of starting my own practice.
Do it. Too much capital.
We need a warehouse.
I can't imagine how we do that.
We should knock that wall down and expand.
Do it. There's always another wall beyond the wall.
We believe you can do whatever you set your mind to, and we'll help you get there. Washington Trust Bank, privately owned, locally invested.
Wake Up Wenatchee Valley is back. I am Dan Kuntz. The person to my immediate left needs no introduction. It's been way too long since we've had her on this program, and that's my bad, Jessica. You've reached out to me. I get busy. I'll get back to her. I get back to you. I get back to you. Jessica Johnson is the executive director of SAGE. October is Domestic Violence Month. And before we get into all the important work that Sage does, the first thing we always have to ask Jessica when she comes by is, how's Hank doing?
Well, as you can see, he's looking pretty good. He's doing well. We have seen an influx of child interviews, and so he's been busy. So he's been in the forensic interview room a lot. He's been doing defense interviews and accompanying people to trial when things come to the time when it's time for them to go to trial. And, you know, doing other things such as just going out and visiting, like we went to the sheriff's office and visited the Douglas County Sheriff's Office. We've been a couple other places. So if you need a Hank visit, you can call us and we'll try to make sure that that happens for people. But, you know, really, he's doing his job well right now. I think you can see.
And it seems to me that if he's busy, that means you're busy, and that's not good.
Yes, we are busy down at Sage. So
I always ask you this question. I said, you know, it's what, how's business? And I always hope Jessica says business is really bad, but you've never said that ever. You always say we're busy, which means
right.
The cycle continues.
Right, the cycle continues, and not only for domestic violence, but also sexual assault, child advocacy center, and our victims of crime program too are busy. So we try to help the people that come in who usually come to see us on their worst day.
And unfortunately, there's been way too many of those lately. We talked about this with Jessica during the height of the COVID. You saw a dramatic uptick in reports of domestic and sexual violence because
yes.
People were locked in together, so to speak. They were mm-hmm. in quarantine together, close quarters, drugs and alcohol. It's just a really bad mix if you're in an unhealthy relationship.
Right. And while drugs and alcohol don't cause intimate partner violence, it does can exacerbate it. So it's one of those things that if you have, it was like the perfect storm. You know, you can't go anywhere, do anything, and people who were trapped with their abusers didn't really have any place that they could go and get help. And so we saw a big number, a big telephone call rise for people who are reaching out, or via different avenues like on Facebook or maybe on Instagram or things like that, where they're trying to get a hold of us. And you know, if you're talking on your cell phone, you know, people can ask you who is that. But if you're like texting, they don't actually know, unless they take your phone away, who that might be that you're talking to.
If you go to the Sage website, the very first thing that pops up, it's a window that pops up, is the number right there. This is the number to call if you're in a crisis right now. How did the people who handle your crisis hotline, which is always manned 24/7, they've been there and done that in most respects. How do they handle a first-time caller when you know that the person who's calling has probably been in this vicious cycle, Jessica, for a long time, but it's finally gotten to the point where they're calling the number and they're asking for help? How does your professionals on your end of that phone handle that?
Well, first of all, they don't ask any questions other than, how can I help you? And then we let the person who's calling in kind of dictate how we're going to do things. Sometimes they just want somebody to listen. Sometimes they're ready right away. That's very few and far between, because as we've talked about before, it usually takes 19 times before a person will leave, so an average of 19 times. That's a whole lot. You know, there are some people who leave on the first instance of violence, and then there are those who stay much longer than 19 times. So, but we let them dictate the process. We're not going to tell you that you need to leave the person that you're with. We're not going to tell you that you should move out. We're only going to provide you information and hopefully validation of what you're feeling.
One of the safety nets that Sage always depended on went away during COVID, and I'm talking about professional educators in North Central Washington. They've been trained to say, you know, I'm looking at Billy, and I don't think anything is up to, mm-hmm. to snuff at the Taylor household or the Jefferson household or what have you. And the teachers have been trained to look for some of the signs that they see in their elementary school and junior high school kids, or even high school kids. That safety net is kind of back now, right,
mm-hmm.
in that respect?
Yes, it is. And I think that's part of the reason we've seen a rise in cases as well, because, you know, we talk about domestic violence, but we also need to talk about violence against children. And children witnessing domestic violence often act out as well. So it's very important that it's just not the parents or the partners that it's affecting. It's affecting the whole family.
Are women with children more apt maybe to stop the cycle as opposed to a single woman who is so dependent on their abuser that they just get back 19, 20, 21 times in a row? Does having a child or even a couple of children in the household with the abuser, does that sometimes expedite things?
Very rarely. I would like to say yes, it does, but...
See, that surprises me. You would think that, you know what, it's one thing to have this going on, but I got kids and these kids have to have a future and it ain't going to be here.
Yeah, usually that's like when they decide to leave, yes, that happens. But the instances of leaving and coming back, those probably happen the same amount of times because they are still dependent, usually financially, on the person who is abusing them. So oftentimes they don't feel like they have any hope. They might not have a job. They might not have a place to go stay. But when that happens, people can call us and we can get them into our shelter at Sage. We unfortunately don't have a place for men right now, but we do have referrals that we can give out. But our shelter houses up to 19 women and children, and it's in an undisclosed location in Chelan or Douglas County.
And undisclosed for a very good reason. You need to be discreet on this, because once that process has started, you want that process to continue to get this situation straightened out.
Yes, we do.
You don't want to shift from third to second gear.
Yes, but that does sometimes happen. We've had people who've checked into our shelter, and we've kind of, you know, checked them in, told them to take the evening, that we'd be back in the morning to check in with them to see what they needed. And in the middle of the night, they're so used to having somebody telling them what to do all the time. Sometimes they just up and leave and they go back. So that's one of those times that the average, when I say 19 times.
You mentioned domestic abuse, actual physical violence, and then there's sexual abuse. And you kind of touched on this a little bit, and we'd like to expand on that a little bit. The idea of the male completely dominating all household decisions, for instance, controlling the checkbook, controlling everything about the person who's being abused life, including monetary.
Right.
They're the only ones who's working. They're going to control the bills, the checkbook. Here's your allowance if you get any at all. That's also a significant part of your job, isn't it?
It is part of our job. And I do want to say, though, that women can be abusers as well as men. So it doesn't really matter. Just like victims can be any color, any race, it doesn't matter. You could be pink with purple polka dots and you can still. It doesn't have any discriminating factors. But yes, the person who controls the finances, you know, they control the money, they might have all the important documents, especially for people who might have immigrated to the U.S. They keep either their passports or their visas or things like that in their control. For citizens, they may keep their passports, their driver's license, their birth certificates, the kids' birth certificates, their social security cards, for safety. And that's hard, you know, hard to do. So we always recommend that if people can, who might be experienced violence, if they can make a copy of those important papers and stick them someplace where they know they'd be safe, whether that be at somebody else's house or, you know, wherever you feel like they would be safe and not discoverable, then that's what we try to have people do.
And one of the fallacies is people always associate this with socioeconomic difficulties, and that's not the case. There are middle-class households and upper-middle-class households all over North Central Washington that may very well be having a domestic violence. You just don't know about it because you're so good at hiding it.
Yes. Yes. The statistic is one in four people know somebody who's been affected by domestic violence. But the issue is that you might not know that you know them. I mean, because domestic violence is the ugly secret. Nobody wants to come out and say, hey, Dan, by the way, I'm being abused at home. I mean, that's just not normal conversation.
No.
So even though you don't think you know somebody, the truth of the matter is you probably do.
October is Domestic Violence Awareness Month. There's any number of things going on, most of it related around this color, purple lavender,
yes,
if you will. This is a nice little light bulb. Explain the purpose of this.
It's part of our Purple Porch Light project. So we're trying to shine the light on domestic violence. So we're asking people either to purchase or swing by our office and pick up a purple light bulb and replace their light bulb for the month of October so it shines purple. And we're hoping to turn all the porches in Wenatchee purple. So, you know, it's really easy this time of year to get a purple light bulb because it's October and it's Halloween. And so that means that they're readily available. But we also have some at the office. If you can't find one, you can swing by and ask for one. And I didn't bring you a pretty one.
That's okay.
I'm
sorry. I'll go get one. I'll head down to Stan's as soon as the show is over and pick one up. I'm sure they got one.
But
every Thursday for the month of October, you're asking people to wear purple.
Purple, that's right. Purple is the color for domestic violence awareness. So we're asking people to wear purple on Thursday. You'll see us at Sage wearing purple on Thursday. You'll see us post on social media. We would encourage you to post on social media as well. It's just, again, to raise the awareness about Domestic Violence Awareness Month. So when somebody asks you, why are you wearing purple every Thursday? That's weird. You can say, well, I'm doing it in honor of those who may be affected by domestic violence. And we know that domestic violence is not the only month of recognition in October, but purple and pink go well together. So, you know, breast cancer awareness and everything else. I mean, you know, but on Thursdays, if you could wear purple, that would be great.
What else is on your mind while I have you here? Because again, I feel bad because I need to have you on more often, and I feel terrible about that. But I have you here. I want to take advantage of the situation. What else is on Jessica's mind right now?
Sure. So there's a lot, and you don't want to know all of it. I swear. But on October 31st, we're going to have our Monster Bash party, parking lot party. We won't be doing the bouncy house this year just because of COVID reasons. And we are asking adults and children who can to wear masks. We are going to be doing our Monster Bash. And so what that is it's a trunk or treat where we have people either drive or walk. We haven't decided yet, probably walk through the parking lot where we invite people to come and do a trunk or treat as far as decorating their trunks and handing out candy to little ones who come in. And that's from 11 to 2 on the 31st. We're kind of piggybacking off of the candy cruise that's happening downtown. So if you have a moment and you want to stop by, ours is a lot smaller, I'm sure. So if you don't want somebody, if you've got a little one that you don't want to have overwhelmed, that might be something that you can do. Also, Hank will be there. I don't know what his costume will be yet, but he'll be there. But we all dress up in costumes, and it's a good time. So we are looking forward to it.
The folks at Sage, as I mentioned this before, I would love to have Jessica out of a job, but unfortunately that's not the case. Let's close out on a positive note. What's a good day for Sage? Not just you, Jessica, but the crew of professionals at Sage. What's when you close up shop at the end of the day and you go home with Hank and your employees scatter to the winds and get ready to come back to work the next day and help out those who need help? What's a good day for you guys at Sage? What's a victory?
A good day is when we know that we've helped people. So, which is pretty much every day. But, you know we have those very hard situations. We know when we get a mom and her kids into our shelter, or we might have been able to make sure somebody has been safe to help get them out of town, or, you know, just in general, knowing that we've helped people. That sounds Pollyanna-ish, but it really isn't, because that's what we do, is that we're here to help people. And it's one of those things that we all love to do. So that's always a good day. It's a good day when we see people make progress. We might see people come in for a year before they decide that they want to leave. And that's okay. You can just come in and talk to an advocate. We might see a little kid whose trial is done and the verdict came back and it was guilty. That's a good day for us. It's a lot of good days that we often comment and talk about, because you've got to take the good and run with it and celebrate the win. Another good day is when we get to have our fun event Enchanted Evening too. So
we'll talk about that's in spring. That's in March.
Yep. So we'll talk about that later. But yes, just having fun, being able to go out and educate people. A good day is actually when you get to go out and interact with people, and you don't have to be closed up in the office too, because we're tired of COVID, just like everybody else.
And you have the perfect introduction in Hank.
Yes.
He just walks in, is wagging his tail and all that stuff.
Yes, just like he did this morning, came in, went straight to somebody. So he's always looking for pets and things like that.
Again, purple light bulb, put it on your front porch, wear purple on Thursdays for Domestic Violence Awareness Month. And one more quick little note. When you're out and about and you see Jessica and you see Hank, if Hank has his vest on, that means he's working. So always, it's just a good idea to ask Jessica for permission if it's okay if you give Hank some love. So it's always okay with Hank, but just it's just the proper thing to do.
Right. So. And most of the time the answer will be yes. But if we're in a courthouse building or someplace like that, probably the answer is no if he's actually doing work. So, but yeah.
It's human nature. You see a big happy dog, you want to pet him.
Right. So. And he is a happy dog, so he's kind of spoiled. I don't know if you've noticed that or not.
Yeah, I kind of noticed that. This is the first time Hank's been here in a couple of years. We haven't gotten him a treat, but we're not sure how old they are. Jessica, it's always good to see you.
It's nice to see you, too.
October, Domestic Violence Awareness Month, and don't forget, there's always help. There's always help. There's always help. Always.
Yes.
Call him. This is for you.
Thank
I'll
you.
I'll buy my own.
Okay. Thank you.
You're watching Wake Up in Wenatchee Valley. We'll be right back.
My name is Brian Thorpe. I own Global Car Care in Wenatchee and have been here for about 25 years.
Brian started Global Car Care as Brian's automotive alternative on Arondo Street.
Some customers were following Brian since Brian's automotive time.
No, we're just grateful to be part of this community. This is where I grew up. We want to do our part to be a valuable part of this community. We want to thank you for trusting our business for 25 years.
Join us for Street Talk and Other Stuff with Mike Magnotti on the NCW Life Channel. This former police sergeant is plugged into not only the world of the streets, he's an actor and connoisseur of the arts. So join Mike and his guest for, well, Street Talk and Other Stuff. Mondays at 10 a.m., Tuesdays and Thursdays at 2 p.m., and Wednesdays at 5:30. It's Street Talk and Other Stuff with Mike Magnotti on the NCW Life Channel.
I'm John Divis from Wenatchee Dental Arts, and I like to think myself as a comprehensive dentist. We are an office that treats people comprehensively for their dental problems. We do a lot of general dentistry in a broad sense. We don't send everything out. Things that we have the ability to do in the office, we like to keep in the office and under one roof and keep things as complication-free as possible. You can come to one place and have all their dental needs taken care of.
In a world afraid of technology, one man, one show will bring you the newest innovations that may just change your life. This summer, Ray McNeil, and your weekly tech update is your weekly tech update with Ray McNeil.
When it comes to finding a memory care community, you want the very best. You want to know that your loved one is safe and receiving compassionate care in a loving environment. Fieldstone Memory Care is an innovative assisted living community designed for those with Alzheimer's, dementia, and Parkinson's disease. You'll find a community specifically designed to enrich residents' lives. The Fieldstone team is here to help you navigate the important decisions you face when a loved one has dementia or Alzheimer's. Welcome home to Fieldstone.
We are back on this Tuesday, a couple of minutes to go. Temperatures around the region, 52 and very steady. 52 in Wenatchee, 52 in Ellensburg. Moses Lake here at 55 degrees. Omak, 52. Downtown Dryden, 49. Downtown Peshaston, 48. But boy, is it going to get chilly. Overnight low is going to get way down there for this time of the year. We're talking tonight's overnight low right around 42, 43. But then overnight low on Wednesday night and on Thursday night will be in the 30s. We're talking upper 30s. We're not talking below freezing. We don't have to worry about that. It'll be 38, 39 or so for the Wenatchee Valley. But there are places out there, and you know who you are, that are susceptible to some pretty chilly overnight temperatures in certain canyons and such, where the sun doesn't really get as much direct sunlight on the planet. And then, therefore, the overnight lows get a little chilly and the air has a tendency to settle, especially near bodies of water. So get ready for some chilly overnight temperatures in the middle of the week from the National Weather Service. Clouds today, wind this afternoon. Yeah, it's going to be up there a little bit anyway. 71 for the afternoon high, 43 for the overnight low. Here's that cold front that's coming in. It's going to bring in some cold temperatures. A lot of sunshine, no rain, no snow, just cold. 63, well, all we'll get to is on Wednesday, our normal afternoon high this time of the year is about 68. So get ready for some chilly temperatures Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, a gradual warm-up
on our way. That's it for us. Have yourself a good Tuesday. We will see you tomorrow. Take care. Bye-bye.